subject irrigation engineering, chapter soil water constants, topic saturation capacity, field capacity and permanent building point. Now students, we have started a new chapter which is the soil water constants, right? So in soil water constant, this chapter is very important because I have seen in past 3, 4, 5 years in GATE examinations, questions are very frequent from this topic, that is the saturation capacity, field capacity and permanent wilting point, right? So now before understanding these three terms, I would like to know you from, If there is a, let's say we have some soil, let us say that I am taking a soil, let us say this is a soil, right, I am taking this soil, okay, the depth of this soil, let us say it is D, right, and the surface area is 1 meter square, this is 1 meter and this is 1 meter, so I have taken a particular cube sample of the depth D and length is 1 meter and the width is also 1 meter, let the for example, okay. Now, this is soil, okay, this is soil. Now, let me use another marker. Let us say this is soil. Soil particles are there, right? Soil particles are there. Some voids will also be there, right? Some voids will also be there. Some voids with air molecules will also be there. Now, if I put some water, let us say this is incoming water stream. This is incoming water stream. Now, if I put some water on this soil sample, where will this water go? Where will this water go? So this is my common sense. Even in my when I was a kid, I used to play with soil. I used to make some toys with soil, right? What I noticed is that if I pour some water on a particular soil sample, some water will be retained. Where will it be retained? It will be retained inside the pores, or can say inside the voids, right? So it will be retained inside the voids, and some water will come down. So this is my common sense. This is my common observation, which I observed when I was a kid. You must have observed this thing also, right? So some water will come down, some water will be trapped inside the pores. That is known as the water holding capacity. I'll be coming to that topic also, water holding capacity of soil. Some water will be coming down. Okay? So this is everybody knows that the water which will be held by this soil sample, it will be inside the pores or inside the voids. Clear? Simple? Now, let us define two terms which you have already discussed in your geotechnical engineering portion. So the first point is known as the porosity. Porosity, which is denoted by N. So what is porosity? It is volume of voids divided by total volume. Now, can I also write this sample as like this, the three-phase system, which you have already done in your geotechnical engineering portion also. So this is your air. This is your water, right? And this is your solid, volume of solid, right? This is volume of solid, volume of water, and volume of air. And volume of air plus volume of water is known as volume of voids. And this is volume of solids, if you remember. Clear? Now, this is porosity. We have another term that is known as the void ratio. Void ratio. That is denoted by E. E is equals to volume of voids upon volume of solids. And you must be knowing, even in your geotechnical engineering portion, you must have seen that we prefer using void ratio over porosity. What is the reason? The reason is that in porosity we have the total volume. So this total volume can change, because this total volume is actually equal to volume of solids plus volume of voids. Volume of solids will be constant, whether you compress soil, whether you do anything with soil, the volume of solids will be constant, but the volume of voids can change. That is why it is a very changing parameter. As far as a void ratio is concerned, volume of solids is constant. So that is why we prefer void ratio over porosity. This thing you must have studied in geotechnical engineering portion, right? Okay. Now, coming to the next part, the pores inside this soil sample, these pores are actually divided into two parts, right? So I can say that the water held by soil sample, water held by soil sample inside pores. And these pores are of two types. So first one is the capillary pores. Capillary pores. Another one is the non-capillary pores. Non-capillary pores. Now what are capillary pores? You must have studied in your fluid mechanics, because I am relating our topics, because in civil engineering every topic is related to one another, right? So in your fluid mechanics you must have heard, even in the soil mechanics also you must have heard about the capillary action. So what is capillary action? Let me again remind you that suppose that you have two soil particles. These are the two soil particles. So if you have, you can say water between these two soil particles, right? So if you have water between these two soil particles, now due to the force of adhesion. Now what is adhesion? The force of attraction between two different molecules. So between force of adhesion between water and the soil particle, this water particles, they will rise up due to the surface tension also, right? Okay, and this is known as the capillary action. If you remember, this is known as the capillary action, right? So we have capillary pores, right? So capillary pores, it has been found that they are small in size. Small in size. Clear? Another thing which has been found about the capillary pores is that they can hold much amount of water against the action of gravity, because gravity is acting in this direction, upward to downwards, and this water is going from downwards to upwards, right? Okay, and if you remember in fluid mechanics, you must have studied that the height of capillary rise, it actually equal to 4 sigma cos theta upon rho into g into d. If you remember, now what is sigma? Sigma is the surface tension. Okay, so the capillary pores, they are small in size. Clear? And they can hold much water. They can hold much water against force of gravity. Clear? Example are clays, right? So these are known as the capillary pores. Now coming to the next type of pores, known as the non-capillary pores. Clear? Now non-capillary pores, they are opposite. So you can say that they are large in size. Large in size. The second thing about the non-capillary pores is that they can hold less amount of water as compared to the capillary pores. So they can hold less water. And the example are sands. So these types of pores are there, right? So water will be inside pores. It can either be inside the capillary pores if it is clay, or it can either be inside of non-capillary pores if it is sand. Simple. Clear? Okay, now let me go to the next topic, next part in this, you can say, in this topic about, we have understood about the capillary pores and non-capillary pores. Now let me teach you what are different types of water. Now you must be asking, sir, we have only one type of water, that is H2O, right? Oh yes, we know that is it. You can say state of water is liquid, that is H2O. But again, if we are talking about the irrigation engineering or fluid mechanics, or even in your geotechnical engineering part, we actually have four types of water. Now let me tell you what type of waters are there, right? So let me rub this. I hope you are getting this, right? Because questions are asked, theoretical questions are asked from this topic. The capillary pores, non-capillary pores, which one is smaller, which one is higher, how much you can say capillary rise there is there in soil, which you must have studied in your geotechnical engineering portion. You must learn the values, right? That how much capillary rise there is there in soils, okay? So now let us discuss about the types of water. And I will make you understand the types of water with this same. Let us say that this is the cross-section area of a soil sample. This is one unit. This is also one unit. The width is also one unit. And the depth is D. D unit, like this. We have a particular soil sample, right? We have soil particles. We also have voids and something, right? Three phase system, it is there, right? So we have four types of water. The first type of water is known as the gravity water. Gravity water. Now, what is gravity water? Now, You must have seen that. I told you that this is a particular soil sample, right? Okay. If I pour some water on it, it can be 1 meter cube of water or 2 meter, whatever water I am pouring in this soil sample. Some water will be held by this soil sample and some water will go downwards. It will come out. This water which comes out due to the action of gravity, simple, right? Because it is coming down due to the action of gravity, because gravity is acting upward to downwards, right? And this water which comes out due to the action of gravity is known as the gravity water, right? So I can write it like this. Do I need to write it? I hope that you have understood, but still I am writing it, right? Okay, the water which comes out, right? Or which travels, that would be more appropriate, which travels due to the action of gravity, the action of gravity is known as the gravity water. Simple. Now, second type of water is known as the capillary water, right? Second type of water is known as the capillary water, right? Now, what is capillary water? Again, I have made you understand that what is capillary water? Some water will be retained by the soil sample. Some water will be retained by the soil sample. Let us say that this is a soil molecule, soil particle, this is a salt particle, soil particle, soil particle. So some water will be retained in between the pores, right? So in between the pores, some water will be retained in between the pores. And due to the forces of adhesion and surface tension, is very important that capillary water is due to surface tension, right? This is due to surface tension and adhesion, right? These two forces are acting, right? So it will rise to some amount, right? Or you can say it will be held by the soil molecule or soil particles, and this water is known as the capillary water, clear? And this action is known as the capillary action. The third type of water is known as the hygroscopic water. Let me use another marker. So third type of water is known as hygroscopic water. Hygroscopic water. I told you that civil engineers play with words, right? Even if you don't know, even in interviews or even in examinations, some theoretical question comes and you don't know what is the answer of this question, just go to the word hygroscopic. This word you must have heard in your class 12th also. So what is this hygroscopic water? Let me make you understand with one example. Now let me give you an example. Let us say that you have a soil sample, right? Let us say that you have a soil sample. This is a soil sample, and you have placed this soil sample. This soil sample also has some moisture in it, right? You have placed this soil sample, let us say, in an oven, and you oven dry this soil sample. This experiment you must have performed in geotechnical engineering part, determination of water content, right? So you oven dry this soil sample. After some time, you take out the soil sample which is without water. Now, if you put this soil sample and in the atmosphere or in open air, then after 1 hour or 2 hour, what you will see is that it has some moisture content in it. Now, from where that moisture content has come? That moisture content has actually come from atmosphere, because atmosphere also has some moisture content, right? So this moisture content or this water absorbed by the soil particles is known as the hygroscopic water. Clear? So you can write it like this, that the water absorbed by soil under the influence of, you can say, in a particular atmospheric condition is known as the hygroscopic water, right? No need to go deep in that, right? So this is hygroscopic water. And this water, again I am repeating, the hygroscopic water, this water, it is totally unavailable for plants, right? I am writing it here, totally unavailable for plants. Unavailable for plants or crops. For plants or crops. It means that, let us say this is your ground level. We have some crops on the ground, right? And this is, now if this is soil, if soil has some hygroscopic water, the plant roots will not be able to extract this hygroscopic water, because you know that to extract water from soil, it needs some, you can say, suction potential or capillary potential should be there to suck water from, you can say, soil. So it has been found by experiments that to get out, to get to extract hygroscopic water from soil, the plant needs to, you can say, needs to suck this water with a pull of 32 atm. 32 atm. Right? Okay? So 32 atm is a very high pressure, so plants will not be able to extract this water, this hygroscopic water, for their growth. Clear? So this water is totally unavailable for plants for their growth, because plants require a lot of power, a lot of pressure has to be applied by the plant roots, right? So how much should be applied, how much pressure should be applied by the plant root? That is 32 atm, and this question has already been asked in some state level examination, right? That what is the amount of suction pressure that is required by plant roots to, you can say, to utilize hygroscopic water. So that is 32 atm. Clear? Okay. So this water is also known as unavailable water. Unavailable water. And this water, capillary water, so it is you can say, responsible for the growth of plants. So whatever water the plants' roots are, you can say, absorbing from soil for their growth is actually the capillary water. And capillary water is also known as available water. Available water. And this gravity water, this is also not, you can say, responsible for the growth of plants. So this is also unavailable water. This also has gravity water or unavailable water. Unavailable water. So which water is responsible for the plant growth? That is the capillary water, right? That is also known as the available water. Clear? Now the fourth type of water is known as the structure water, right? So let me write it here, right? So let me use another marker. Let me write about what type of next water type is structure water. Structure water. Now, what is the structure of water? So, for example, let me take one soil particle. Let us say this is a soil particle. Clear? Okay? Now, it has been found, if you look at the microscopic studies, so if you will find that on the surface of the soil, we have a very thin layer of water on the surface of soil due to the forces of adhesion, right? We have very thin layer of water on the surface of soil particles, right? Now, to extract this soil part, extract this water, what needs to be done is that if you oven dry soil at a very high temperature, very high means greater than 110 degrees Celsius, then what will happen? The structure of soil will break, and this water, we can extract it by heating it at a very high temperature. So now, this is the reason, if you remember, in your geotechnical engineering portion, when you are doing your oven dry method process to determination of water content, you are not increasing the temperature of oven greater than 110 degrees Celsius. This question has also been asked in the SSC JEE examination, that what is the maximum temperature for oven dry process, that is 110 degrees Celsius. But why we are not going beyond 110 degrees Celsius? Because it's structural water, then it will get extracted. So it will give us erroneous results, right? Because actually we do not want the structural water. It does not play any role either in the plasticity or in any form, right? Only thing is that it is tightly bound with the soil particles, right? Okay, so that is why we are not increasing the temperature of oven beyond 110 degrees Celsius, right? So structure of water, this is the structure of water, H2O, right? It also gets broken, and the structure of soil, it also gets, you can say, distorted shape of the structure of soil is also there, right? If you increase the temperature to a very high temperature, right? So this is the structure water. But the most important is capillary water, because this water is available for plants. Clear? And that is also known as the available water. Simple, right? So now let's move forward. Now let's understand another term that is known as soil moisture tension, SMT, right? Now then I will be coming to this thing, that is the saturation capacity, field capacity, and permanent building point, right? So we have understood about the types of water, what are the different types of water, and which water is responsible for the growth of plants, that is capillary water, right? So now let's move to another, you can say, another point, that is known as soil moisture tension, right? Soil moisture tension, that is also denoted by SMT, right? So soil moisture tension, you can say that it is actually the force required per unit area. I am writing here, so force required per unit area, right? So force required per unit area to remove water from soil, to remove water from soil, right? So it is actually the force required per unit area to remove water from soil. I already gave you an example that hygroscopic water, right? So the hygroscopic water, the plant needs a lot of, you can say, SMT, soil moisture tension, a lot of force required per unit area. How much for the hygroscopic water? It is 30 to 80 m for hygroscopic water. For hygroscopic water, it is very high. That is around 30 to 80 m. Clear? Okay. This term, which is known as soil moisture tension, SMT, it is also known as force of suction. It is also known as force of suction. It is also known as capillary tension. Capillary tension, right? So SMT is also known as the force of suction or capillary tension, or it is also known as capillary potential. Capillary potential, right? So it has many names, capillary potential, right? Generally, the soil moisture tension in normal case, right, it varies from 1 by 10 to 1 by 380 m. 1 by 10 to 1 by 380 m is the general, you can say, the general soil moisture tension or SMT or capillary suction potential or the force of suction, capillary potential force of suction that is required by the plants to absorb the capillary water, right? Generally, it is 1 by 10 to 1 by 380 m, but for hygroscopic water, it is 30 to 80 m. So it is almost next to impossible for plants to use this hygroscopic water for their growth. Clear? Okay. Now let's come to the next topic, and then we'll be starting this saturation capacity. Now let's come to the next topic, that is known as the moisture content, right? So let me rub this, and let's come to next point, that is known as the moisture content, right? I hope you have got it, because this was important, right? So soil moisture tension, SMT. So next is moisture content. Moisture content, right? So in moisture content, now I told you that you must be knowing about the three phase system. This is your solid, this is your water, and this is air, right? This is volume of air, this is volume of water, this is volume of solids, right? Okay, and this is also known as the void ratio, V, void ratio, not void ratio, sorry, volume of voids, okay, right? Okay. So this is, you know, about, right? Now what is happening is that if I completely, now again I'm repeating, if I completely replace the air voids with volume of water, if I completely replace the air voids with volume of water, if I keep adding water and all the air voids are completely filled by water, then this type of soil is known to have a, you can say, the soil has actually saturated. Clear? So I can say that there is a term known as the degree of saturation. Degree of saturation. Degree of saturation is given by the volume of water divided by the volume of void. If in percentage you are taking it, just multiply it with 100. If in percentage, right? So, degree of saturation is denoted by S. Clear? Okay, now what will happen if whole the volume of void, they are completely filled by, you can say, volume of water. So I will be saying that a degree of saturation is 1 or 100%. Right? It means that when the soil has attained the maximum amount of volume that a particular soil can have is the saturation capacity. Clear? Okay? So I hope that you have understood about the saturation capacity. And when you have zero amount of water, when you have zero amount of water in soil, let us say that I have one dry soil and even this water, it has escaped. And what will happen? Then these voids will be filled by volume of air. So I will say that if volume of water will be zero, then degree of saturation will be zero. And this is known as a dry soil. Dry soil. This is known as a saturated soil. Saturated soil. All these things you must have done in your geotechnical engineering portion also, right? So S is equals to 1 and S is equals to 0. Now let's come to the field capacity. Okay, we have understood the saturation capacity, right? So this is the maximum amount of water that a soil can actually have, right? That is the known as the saturation capacity, right? Now let us understand about the field capacity. Now let us remove this, let me rub this, right? Now let us understand what is field capacity, right? So coming to the next term, that is the field capacity. Field capacity. Now let me give an example. Let us say that this was the soil sample. This is 1 meter square area. 1 meter, 1 meter, and it has a certain depth, that is, it is D. The depth is D of the soil sample. Okay. Now you have added some water. And initially, this soil sample, it was confined in a particular space. It is, let us say, a metallic box, it is, right? It is, it has, the soil sample has been confined, and you keep on adding water, until this is your outlet, right? Until some water comes out, right? So you keep adding water, right? Okay. Now, the water which you have added to that particular soil sample after all the air voids have been excluded or taken out is known as the saturation capacity. But what will happen if this, you can say, the soil sample, it was not confined? What would happen? Let me tell you. Let us say that if you add some water in an unconfined soil sample, right? If you add some water in an unconfined soil sample, I told you that some water will come out. Right? Let us say that you have added, let us say, 5 meter cube of volume of water, right? So some water will come out. Let us say that 2 meter cube has come out, and this is known as the gravity water. I have already told you. Now how much water is left inside it? So it inside it, it has 5 minus 3, right? That is 2 meter cube. Sorry, 5 minus 2, right? 5 minus 2, that is 3 meter cube of water, or volume of water, is still inside the, you can say, soil sample, and this is an unconfined soil sample, right? That is not bound by any metallic or any surface, right? So this volume of water, it will be known as the field capacity. Yeah? So I can say that the field capacity will be equal to saturation capacity, because for 5 meter cube it was saturated, minus the gravity water. Or I can say that the maximum water holding capacity of a particular soil sample is known as the field capacity. Maximum water holding capacity, because this water the soil cannot hold actually, right? So the only volume of water which the soil has hold, that is 3 meter cube of water, volume of water the soil has hold, and this is known as the field capacity of the particular soil sample. Okay? Now let's move to the next point, that is known as a permanent wilting point, PWP, right? So let me rub this. So I hope that you have got about what is field capacity, right? And types of water I have already told you. Now let us come to the permanent wilting point, PWP, right? So permanent wilting point, okay? Now let me give an example, okay? Let us say that initially you had plants on a particular agricultural land, so they were easily, the roots of the plants could easily extract water from soil, right? Okay, simple. Now what will happen during summer days? The moisture content will slowly decrease. Clear? Now if the moisture content will decrease, the plants will find it very hard to absorb water or to extract water from, you can say, from soil. Right? There will be one point in the moisture content, there will be one point that beyond which the plants will not be able to extract water from soil. And the plants, what will happen? They will start dying. So you can see just by the appearance of the plants that they have turned yellow, or your crops have turned yellow. Now what you will do is that, then you will irrigate the particular land. Now you have understood that, okay, the plants are not able to extract water from soil. Now it's trying to irrigate the land. Clear? Now, that amount of least amount of water that the plants can extract from soil is known as a permanent building point, right? PWP. So I can write it like this. The least amount of water, so saturation capacity is the upper point and permanent building point is the lower point, simple, right? So I can write it there that saturation capacity is the upper point, this is the upper point, and this is the lowest point. This is the lowest point. So I can say that the permanent building point is the least amount of water that that plants can extract from soil. Plants can extract from soil. Now let me draw one diagram, and with the help of the diagram you will be easily able to remember what is saturation capacity, what is field capacity, and what is permanent building. Simple, right? Now let me draw one diagram, right? The diagram is like this. This is your saturation capacity. Now, this is, let us say, your ground. This is a ground level. You have crops here, right? The saturation capacity. Now, saturation capacity is the maximum water that I can add to a particular soil sample, right? Okay. Now, if you add maximum water, what will happen? Some amount of water will come down. That is one of the gravity water, gravitational water. So, some amount of water will come here, right? This is known as the gravity water. This is known as the gravity water, right? And what happens that if from the saturation capacity, you subtract gravity water, what you get? You get field capacity. So this point is the field capacity. Field capacity, that is FC. That is not completely saturation capacity, because this is important. This diagram is important, right? Saturation capacity, SC, right? And field capacity. Yeah, okay. Now, this water, the just below the field capacity, the plants can easily get this water. Let us say that these are the crops. This is your ground level. Let us say these are the crops, or these are the plants, or whatever, right? Okay, they can easily extract water. Okay. Now, if the plants, they keep on extracting water, now what will happen? It will deplete. The depletion of water level will start. It will reach. Okay, plants can absorb. Plants can still extract water. But there will be some point. That if the water level goes beyond this point, the plants will not be able to extract the water and they will start dying. And this point is known as the permanent wilting point. Permanent wilting point, PWP. Permanent wilting point. Okay. This is gravity water. Okay. Now I hope that by this diagram, you have understood about the moisture content in a particular soil sample. Saturation capacity, field capacity, permanent building point. Now you will be saying that, sir, okay, now I have understood that this moisture content is actually available for plants. The plants can grow just by absorbing this moisture content, because beyond this, they will not be able to extract, and above this, there is no moisture content because it is gravity water. It has actually fallen down. So this moisture content, which is between the field capacity and the permanent wilting point, is actually known as the available moisture. Available moisture, that is also known as AM. So I can say that available moisture will be equal to field capacity minus permanent wilting point. Field capacity minus permanent wilting point. There is another term that is known as the readily available moisture. Let me write it here. So we have understood available moisture. Available moisture we have understood. Right? There is another term known as the readily available moisture. Readily available moisture. So that is actually easily available to plants. Right? Even if the water level reaches just near to the wilting, permanent wilting point, still the plants will be able to extract the water, but with a greater difficulty. So there is a level that without any difficulty the plant can absorb water, right? And that level is actually known as the readily available moisture. So this is the readily available moisture, RAM, right? Readily available moisture. So this level is the readily available moisture. Now the question is, sir, so what is the actually the value? What is actually the value of this? So it has been found that just by the experiments also, that the readily available moisture, is almost 75% of the available moisture. Almost to 75% of the available moisture, right? So now what is the, you can say, significance of readily available moisture? So what we do is that whenever the water content, again I'm repeating, whenever the water content it falls below readily available moisture, we irrigate the land. We do not wait for the permanent wilting point, because once the it has reached the permanent wilting point, the plant has actually dead. The plant is dead. It is not able to extract water. So what we do is that once the water content it is just below the readily available moisture, we irrigate the land. Clear? Okay. Now let me give you, let me draw, you can say, one graph, right? So one graph you will be able to understand. That graph is about the frequency of irrigation, right? So the graph is about the frequency of irrigation. Let me rub this, right? I hope you are getting it, because this is important, right? So let me draw one graph in which you will be understanding about the frequency of irrigation. Frequency of irrigation, right? So let us understand the frequency of irrigation. Frequency of irrigation. Now graph, on the y-axis I have the moisture content. Moisture content. On the x-axis I have time in days. Clear? Moisture content can be percent or whatever, but generally percent, right? So this is the saturation capacity. This is the saturation capacity. This is the field capacity. And this is the permanent wilting point. And here we have the readily available moisture. Readily available moisture. Clear? Okay. So this is the readily available moisture. Clear? Okay. Now what is happening is that let us say that initially at t is equals to 0, the plant was at the field capacity. For example, let us say it has the maximum moisture content, it is at the field capacity, because this is not actually available to plants. This is gravity water, right? This is gravity water. This is available water up to here, available water, and up to here, that is readily available water or readily available moisture. Okay, now what will happen as the time will pass, if you are not irrigating land, what will happen? It will, the moisture content will slowly, let me like this, it will slowly decrease. Now once it has reached the RAM, that is the readily available moisture level, what you do? You irrigate the land. So once you irrigate the land, it will directly go up. The moisture content will directly go up. Clear? Now the question is, sir, why it is going straight up, why it is not going like this? Because we are talking about days. So once you have irrigated a land in a particular day, let us say it is a 4th of June, 5th of June, whatever. So in that particular day, you irrigate the land and on the same day, it goes up. Okay? But it is a time-taking process. 1 day, 2 day, 3 day, 4 day, 5 day and so on. Okay? Now, it has reached here. What will happen again? Now you have stopped irrigation because the plants are getting the water to their full capacity. Now after some time, what will happen? 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, it will again start depleting. And once again they reach the ready level moisture content level, you again irrigate the land, right? So it will again go up. And so on, right? So this is the graph between the frequency of irrigation. It means that this time period, let us say it is TF. So this TF is known as the frequency of irrigation. That is means after TF days, you have to irrigate the land, right? So TF is known as the frequency time. Frequency time is the TF. Clear? Okay. So I hope that you have understood all these topics: the saturation capacity, the field capacity, the permanent wilting point, the frequency of irrigation. All these topics you have understood very well, right? So now it's time to implement the concepts, and it's time to solve a few numerical based on this topic. So next video, what I'll be doing is that we'll be solving some numericals based on these concepts. Thank you.